Vera's got Krista, Dom's got Darlene, and Elliot has Olivia. Everyone wants something, and nobody's giving it up. That means you've got to start pressing in that soft underbelly of the heart. It's Mr. Robot. 406, not acceptable. Hey everyone, Dee here, and welcome to this week's review of Mr. Robot. So, as usual, spoilers coming your way, and do want to remind you about our quick jump index system. Right in the description below, we'll have this entire review titleized, codified, and time stamped. You can jump to the middle of the review first, watch the end second, watch the beginning last. You can watch this review in any order you'd like. All right, so 406. Not acceptable. A rare, very, very rarely seen error code. Basically what that means is that the server cannot respond to a request within the parameters of the acceptable values of that request. I know, it's an odd one. It's basically another syntactical type error, and that's why it's not really generally used a whole lot, because it can mean everything from your keyboard set wrong, it's a wrong language, character subsets off. It's a very murky kind of error code. But what we can basically look at is you want somebody to do something, you want them to accept a certain reality, accept a certain rule, and it is saying no. You got to ask in a different way. You have to offer different variables. And that's really what this episode is about. Everybody wants information. They want someone to accept, in many ways, a new reality, cave in, give up what is wanted, and everybody is basically saying no. So how do you do that? Well, kind of like a method not allowed, you're working for a reach around. Sorry about that. You're looking for a workaround, an entirely different circumstance there, where and usually with this, it tends to go, like I mentioned in the opener, with the heart. Family specifically. That's where everybody ends up pushing. Whether it's Vera wanting to give up Elliot, she's not going to do it. Whether it be from professional pride or just not want to be bushed around. Only way to get to her is using the boyfriend Jason as a negotiating tactic. Dom and Darlene, kind of similar things. While Darlene is motivated to protect family, Dom's motivation is, of course, also to protect family. Her family is threatened if she doesn't do what Janice and the rest of the Dark Army want. And then, of course, Elliot threatening Olivia's kid in order to get what he wants. So everybody is trying one way, then they try another way, and ultimately it comes to get into the heart in order for people to give things up. With some interesting results, depending on the particular storyline. So, Vera's got Krista and opens up the episode with the story of the bully and little bitch, which is an excellent villain story. You always notice the villains always have a great story in order to unsettle their victim. It seems to be a standard trope. And Vera does it well. It's one thing that I can say. While I'm not necessarily a huge fan of him and his storyline, to me it's just kind of a distraction from the good, meaty, juicy bits of everything else, hacking particularly. I have to say, Vera owns all of the scenes that he is in. He is a great personality, and they really play a lot with the comedy and the intensity and the softness and the terror, all very well. A lot of very tight camera work within these shots. A lot of stuff very tight on Vera's face as he's telling the story, and he is getting up and closer into his little moments with Krista. It's a very well done, from a cinematic scope, very well done of getting us involved and held and holding our breaths and waiting for the next thing. And like I said, the scenes are just really well done. We have great interplay between Vera and Krista. I love how he does his whole thing and meant to intimidate and what the little bat can do, and then Krista turning that all back around on him, you know, saying, oh, just because you were bullied as a little kid doesn't mean you have to do all these. It's a great use of her psychology to kind of see where Vera's coming from and turn it back on him. Which, of course, he then gets the chance to turn back around at him. Again, in a perfect way of like, oh my god, you've got me. I'm stunned. Are you saying that you're calling me a little bitch? And, you know, gets it with all of his guys around. It's just a nice interplay back and forth of who is in the position of power here. And it's also Vera, again, trying new approaches. Oh, that story didn't work. Well, let me explain this to you. You're the bat. You are here for purpose. Your purpose is to deliver Elliot, and I will use whatever it takes in order to do that. Ultimately, like I mentioned before, it comes to pushing on the heart, and then, of course, Jason, the boyfriend, showing up for their little twosome Christmas togetherness. Not quite working out the way that it was intended. And just, again, just a great, just really, like I said, great moments, even with Vera kind of at the end getting into Chris's face and saying what that he wants to do with Elliot, the importance, the spiritual connection that we have with Elliot. And much like, you know, ultimately going to the bully's hospital bed and being the one sympathetic character that can help rebuild this person, that is Vera's goals. To break Elliot down, to use Krista's knowledge, break Elliot down, and then be the one to build him back up. Thus, that's how you own someone. You make sure you destroy them. You basically become their god, in a way, of the world. You destroy them, and then you build them back up and give them character. And that is, in Vera's mind, the way to own Elliot, the way to get him to do what he wants. And ultimately, Krista has to give that method up to him, which of course ends up being Mr. Robot. Meanwhile, of course, Dom and Darlene are having a reunion that no one really expected, at least not to occur in this manner. I have to say, I like the moment that we had on the phone conversation right as the scenes opened up, between Elliot and Darlene, really showing that connection, the change, the evolution of their relationship. Elliot apologizing for saying, I wish you didn't come back into my life. That was an a-hole thing for me to do. And I really love Darlene's response. Keep your phone on you. You know, you still have that program. Keep your phone on you. I don't want to lose you again. It's just a nice little brother-sister moment. Kind of immediately interrupted as far as Darlene goes with Dom's gun in her face looking for Elliot. And yeah, kind of a fun little sequence here. I loved how Dom kind of holds the gun on to get the information. It's like, do you have it? No, and then drops it. And I'm like, is she just going to walk away? She can't give up on this so easily. And then starts to call on Darlene's thing. No, you can't call the FBI. They'll let the Dark Army know and they'll send somebody out. And Dom's just like, they already did. AKA me. I'm the one. Remember, you put me here. Which really holds, I think, a lot of the great tension in this scene between Dom and Darlene is because, yeah, Darlene is responsible for putting Dom in this situation. She slept with her, she used her, she acted to her, she pulled her into the whole thing, and now Dom has to deal with the consequences of that. Funnily enough, now possibly ending Darlene's life. So it's a whole kind of circular aspect going on right here. But yeah, that whole past relationship moment does hold a lot of tension. I thought it was kind of messed up of Darlene, you know, pushing that, you know, that time that we were together, it was nice. What are you gonna give it up? I mean, come on, Darlene's gonna try whatever it is that she can. And does that, I think, very well throughout this scene. But yeah, a little expected that Dom does this. I mean, of course she has to call up Janice, report. I love the little code words that they're using on the phones to kind of, I guess, let her know who's answering and who's on the phone. It's kind of a nice, simple way. They don't dwell on it, but that way you don't have, like, Darlene answering Dom's phone and kind of a Dom's voice kind of thing. And anybody spilling out information. So just like a small little thing there. But I like that moment. And then, of course, it turns around that we just need Elliot. You can get rid of Darlene. I love the fact that Dom also had heard the conversation and knowing that Darlene's phone had Elliot's location on that. Again, it's just, I love it when characters are smart And it's not like the moment they appear, everything else is there. They've got more going on. There's a lot of depth that handles in with these things, and I think that that works out really well. And some great intensity, too. When Darlene gets pulled into the bathtub and Dom is ready to shoot her, it's a great moment. We get great music in the background. We've got Darlene constantly yelling, "You don't have to do this. You don't have to do it." We're getting the close-up on the finger. You get the gun. You get the finger moving in the trigger. You get Dom's face. You get that conflict because, of course, she doesn't want to do this. She is not a murderer. That's not what she got into. She hates what the whole Dark Army is doing. And they really hold that tension great. So when Dom kind of flips and hits Darlene and knocks her out, it's everything stops right there. It's like that moment tension release. Again, just really, really well executed. And then leading into that following bit where we have just Dom the whole time waiting for time. What are we going to have to do? Worried of Janice, who, of course, has already thrown up. What's that great threat? Are you going to be able to do this? Because last time you weren't 100%, wasn't sure. And if you're not, I just need to be sure to make out time to go back to your home and kill your mom and your whole family. Okay? That cute little Janice voice. So, yeah, all of that tension. It was handled well. And then that final bit, those final moments, the clock is ticking down, the choices are out. What do we have? Come on, you know it's our scene of the week for this week. And yes, that is the whole Darlene waking up, Dom realizing that she is out of time, few choices, what's going to happen? Is she gonna drag her out? I also love the fact that for a moment, it's almost like I was just waking you up in order to see if that you would unlock your phone. Your phone's locked. I need you to do that before I shoot you. I don't know. Maybe it's an iPhone. Those are hard to pack to break into, aren't they? Government could do it. Anyway, so I mean, that kind of, again, that pulled up the tension. And then when Dom's dragging her out, where are they going to go? And Dom asks Darlene to shoot her. You have to kill me. You have to shoot me. We'll say that you got away. And it's really, in that way, her only way out. One of two attempted suicides in order not to accept these new requests that are being enforced upon by outside forces. Again, R406, not acceptable. Dom willing to die in order to protect her family. And it is a choice. Can't get mad at Dom. She's dead. No reason to punish the family. Dom evidently failed. So in a way, it's her only way out. And it does explain why she's had so much tension that she's been trying for the past 2 months to kill herself and hasn't been able to get to it. So the tension that's all ratcheted up there, we get the whole moment again, the two of them yelling, "I don't want to kill you. It's the only way. It's the only way." And then door opens up and just the two goons walk in. I wasn't expecting this. And one, I'm kind of surprised that Darlene didn't just pull up the gun and shoot her right there. Maybe, again, it's a stunned moment. Overwhelmed but Dark Army. Maybe didn't think that she was quick on the draw enough. I was kind of waiting for that. Surprised it didn't happen. I thought that was where that scene was going to go. But as Janice threatens Dom and then gets up into Darlene's face, "You just watch your brother gun to her head. I have..." And even says, even though while she pushed on Dom, kill Darlene, she kind of gives to Darlene right here, "I just want your brother now. I don't need you." Sort of implying the whole, "I won't kill you if you won't do this." Which is sort of what Vera had promised Krista as well. "If you give me what you want, what I need, I won't have to kill you. Here's a whole nother way. Can't do the heart. Maybe I'm going to do your life. Maybe I'm going to give you reach. Maybe I'm going to do this different options in order to get what I want." And while everybody has resisted, as everyone has pushed, it's the scene of the week because Darlene does the unacceptable. She wipes her phone while they're talking. "Oh, is that all you want? Well, you can't have it because my phone's just wiped. Now you got nothing." And the only person in our three storylines to successfully turn it back around on the request server, on the person who is asking for the information. So it's a perfect job for the hacker to be the one to turn things around when we're talking about hacking error codes. And again, even for Janice, a very unexpected direction for that scene to go, and why it's the scene of the week for the week. And the whole Elliot and Olivia sequence, easily the most messed up, honestly, of the entire episode. While, look, there's intensity going on. Vera can be threatening. Nobody wants to die. Darlene's caught in a spot. Dom is trapped between a rock and a hard place. All these are uncomfortable. The Elliot Darlene is painful. And I think it's good that Mr. Robot is talking to us all about crossing lines. Do you have a line anymore? How far is too far? Is it important to have these limits? Is that, in a way, what retains our humanity? Because in many ways, this is where Elliot loses it all. I mean, not that he hasn't done bad things before. He has. But drugging an addict in order to get information, and to do it so just cruelly, showing up, oh, it's Christmas in a cup. And I always think about Wally. It's Christmas in a cup, plus with drugs. Yeah, good for you. And a lot of tension, again, also held well. A lot of long camera shots done within all of these sequences. Even the whole opening bit where we get the introduction. We're here. Oh, do you want to come in? It's nice. It's Dady. Like Olivia, like Elliot, they've got a connection, and he just throws it all away in this. Okay, he's out of time. Clock's ticking down. Has to do something now. Needs a for sure way to do it. Can't massage and negotiate the system. I get this. But really, from Elliot also, who's an addict himself. As he throw off, you'll get over it. Yeah. To do this to someone. To pull it around. I mean, before they even did that reveal, I was wondering what his approach was. Because when he's just like, okay, here's your company. It's evil. It's corrupt. It's doing this. It's doing that. Of course she's going to say no and throw his ass out. How did he think any of that was going to work? That was not subtle in any way. He didn't build that up. He didn't work it. He didn't massage it. He didn't do anything. And we get that long, uncomfortable camera hold as he's ready to walk out, and the camera slowly moves in and he stares. And for a moment, I was wondering if he is switching to his third personality. There's a lot of talk about that, the big third personality. Again, I'm not getting into too much of it because right now it's just a tease. And I know that this is not his third personality because this is exactly the plan that Mr. Robot and him discussed beforehand, which Mr. Robot was concerned about. So all information is being shared right here. No third personality going on. This is all Elliot. What if you failed your drug test? And even throughout the whole scene, I was hoping that it was going to turn out that he just lied about that. Oh, I didn't drug it. Of course, we know that that's not the case. And I think that was throughout the scene we see Olivia changing, her body chemistry changing, the kind of sweat, the nervousness, everything else, that is the drug sort of affecting her. They work this really well throughout the scene. But just the cruel dynamics between this love relationship that was potential being pulled out and then ultimately being threatened back. You could lose your kid if you don't give me what I want. She tries. She does. And when she left to go to the bathroom, I was honestly, first thing I thought about was that razor blade. I'm like, no, well, does she have pills in there? Is she going to hit herself up? Is she going for the pills? And they wait in nice. Again, another great camera bit as she leaves and the camera just moves and pulls back. And then suddenly we've got Mr. Robot there and the whole concerns and talks and so on right there. Concerns about crossing the line, and as we hear the thud, he bring the thud of Olivia's body hitting the ground. So he brings up the dread. And the only good thing about the dread is the fear that you just crossed a line. And because you crossed a line, at least a line is still there. Because once the lines are all behind you, there is nothing but darkness ahead of you. Once you have gone too far, you become the monster, which is effectively what Elliot has done. and Olivia tells him straight off at the end of the scene. I mean, not a total monster. He does save her life, and it's not just to use her. I think the indication of the phone had rung a few times to see that her boss had tried to call her back. He didn't try to rouse. He didn't try to answer. He was dedicated in trying to save her life. He didn't want her to die. That's not where he wants to go. He does, I think, on a level, Elliot, regret the choices he's having to make. He just feels he doesn't have any other choice. And then it, when Olivia does turn around and help, again, the massacre that he had brought up, one of the many things that the Deus group is responsible for, that's the same massacre that her mom had died in. Okay, willingness to help, to cross the line, but not for Elliot, for a larger kind of purpose. Because I think for Olivia, yeah, she knows her life is in many ways over. She's trying to kill herself not to keep from giving the information to Elliot, but to protect her family. Because what she says, you might be able to recover from this, but I can't. It wrecks my life. She is concerned not just about losing her kid, but what all of that will do to her family and her kid and the viewpoint and everything else. The intensity of being willing to cross your own life off in order to protect the ones that you love is how hard the stakes that we are playing with in this game, and the stakes that Elliot pushes on, which is why Olivia tells him, you are a monster. I may work for monsters, but you are a monster, and you're the worst kind because you don't know it yet. You don't realize. How many lives have you destroyed? Was all those questions that she's asked. It's just a perfect summation of how far Elliot has dropped, how far he's, what he's willing to sacrifice, what he's willing to lose of himself, and ultimately does ask the question, is he really the hero? He did try and save her life, a small heroic act, but does that make up for everything else? I think that's really an important question left out there. Perhaps even a more interesting question, considering White Rose's response to his assistant, wanting to take out Elliot. Has gone too far? No, we need him. Take him out, and his shipping hat goes with him. I'm not really sure how all that works, why Elliot has to be kept alive, but, and yet he's still working against them. Can he just not do what he is supposed to do, or can they not get, I don't know. It's a little fuzzy right there, why he has to be kept alive, but in a way allowed to create problems. But I guess this is where White Rose throws in the solution. Bring him in. I want him to see that we're not on, that we're both on the same side. Considering the monstrous things that he's kind of done, that's not so far out of reach, but I'm not sure, I don't think that's what White Rose means. So hopefully that means we're gonna get to learn more about this project that has been up in the air forever. Please, what is this all about? All right, just a couple of small things. One, Joey Badass popping up again in this episode as what? The Mission Impossible kind of equipment delivery guy? Is he the new Q to Elliot's 007? Here are your supplies, sir. Let me know if you need anything else. Why? Because he's a free contractor now, free agent. But is he? I mean, I don't know. It's kind of an odd, just brief little moment. Is he there just to drop off supplies? That seems kind of odd. I think we're definitely going to see more of him. But the statement of, I'm a free agent now. My only loyalty is to the dollar. Call me up. I don't know if I would entirely believe that. Does the Dark Army allow that to happen and to work against their interests? I don't totally believe Joey right there. In the midst of Vera's encounter with Krista, there is Vera's accusation of, you loved him. I saw it on your face. Well, Vera is very good at determining motivations and characters and impulses. That's his secret weapon. But an interesting bit to see if Krista actually had feelings for Elliot would sort of make sense in a certain kind of way. I mean, there was a closeness, but most of her actions and reactions, I thought, were very understandable from a professional level. But that certainly reacted to Krista. So interesting to see how that plays out. especially since she just suckered him into being kidnapped by Vera here at the end. So, yeah, I don't think that he let her go. Another great little directorial choice when Elliot first starts opening up to Olivia there and talking about her job, the bank where she worked. It was a great bit of the hands that they had held and the camera dropping down, and you just see the hand, boom, just pull away. It was a nice bit of just showing that intensity of response without being overly dramatic. Just a nice little touch there. All right, well, I think that pretty much covers everything. So next week, it looks like Vera's going to try and bring Elliot over to his dark side for another bit in Christmas. We got a lot of stuff going on with this Christmas. A lot of episodes, like half the season, I think, is going to end up covering Christmas Day. Because we still have the Deus meeting that's supposed to happen like at 9 o'clock at night. So what? We had the morning, which was breaking into virtual reality. We had now, which was Elliot trying to get Livy to call her boss to get his access work so they can get in to transfer all of their funds. Later on tonight, he's going to have to break into the Deus group in order to hack all of their phones in order to get their passcodes so we can initiate the transfer. But in the meantime, he's got to deal with Vera. Yeah, it's a very big Christmas for Mr. Robot. A lot going on. But that's going to be it for us for now. Thank you, as always, for joining me with these reviews. And if you enjoyed it, please go ahead and hit that like button. You know there's a bell down there, too. Hit that. That's for notifications. That will let you know whenever a new D's Reviews drops. And we've got some coming up. We're still several more episodes for this first half season of Walking Dead. The rest of Mr. Robot here. And The Mandalorian starting up on Tuesday. So lots of stuff. Don't miss any of that. Comments in the section below. What do you guys think about this episode? What are your favorite parts? Is Elliot the monster that he is going to become? Any hope for him and Olivia? I don't think so. And what'd you think about Darlene's little badass hacker phone wipe and move? Let me know your thoughts. Throw those down in the section below. You can always catch me on Twitter and Instagram. I am at Darren Jakes. You can hit this button to subscribe, and I'll throw up a couple of latest reviews right here for you to check out. So, that's going to be it for me. I'm D, and I'm out of here. Catch you guys next time. Bye-bye.